Kees Lensing, thank you for joining me here, former Blue Bulls and Namibia international. So, what's the weather like in New York at the moment?
Man, this morning, inside is very nice, but outside it's a little bit chilly. We sit about at -7 degrees Celsius, so nice and fresh.
Well, of course, the weather would have been a bit better in San Diego, so just take us through the game. I know you said that it was a tough win. It wasn't pretty, but you'll take it.
Yeah, I know. The weather was perfect down there. All of us were so surprised. I couldn't believe it's the same country, because we left New York here in minus degrees, and we get down there and it was like 25 degrees Celsius. The sun was shining. There was no wind. And there was a grass pitch. In New York, we don't have natural pitches to train on, so just because of the weather conditions. So it was really amazing conditions down in San Diego. Wish we had more time to spend there. The game itself, because it was the first game for a lot of the guys, the first game, one of our preseason games got cancelled. So there was a lot of the guys that never have played together. So we knew from the beginning it's going to be a tough game, because it literally was the first outing for a lot of these guys to play as a unit together. We started off really well. First half, I think our game management was well. We played in the right areas. And we scored two really good tries. But then they started coming back slowly into the game. They got a yellow card there forward. One of the guys got a yellow card. And I don't think we capitalized on that really. We took the points. We took 3 points. But at that stage of the game, it was just before halftime, we should have, I think, rather went for the corner and keep them down there and maybe see if we couldn't get another try on them. But then they kicked back to us. We made a little bit of a mess up of the exit play, and it was a penalty, conceding another penalty, and the stress was immediately on us, and they scored just before halftime. And then they were back into the game. And then the second half, for some other reason, the boys switched off a little bit. Probably we as coaches have to go and look at our mid-game talk. And in the next 10 minutes of the second half, we conceded five penalties in the first 10 minutes of the second half, and they were back into it immediately. And then it was an uphill battle the whole time for us. Luckily for us, unluckily for them, we had the ball and we attack again to the end of the game. They were up by the stage, I think, if I correctly, 21-18, I think was the score, or 22-18. And we had a bit of an overlap, and we played the ball, and their winger tried to intercept, but he knocked the ball down. And nowadays, the rules in that area, part of the field, if you knock the ball down, kind of try to intercept, It was a yellow card and a penalty try. And that saved us to the end of the day. Yeah, so. Like again, I said, there was a game of ups and downs. We started well, but there's still a lot of improvement for us.
You did mention that a number of players joined you late and hadn't played together. So how was the whole trip from a bonding point of view? I mean, you had to fly from one end of the continent to the other. And that must have been a nice time for you guys really to get together, get that team culture going. And then, of course, a win and 100% record in Major League Rugby doesn't hurt either.
First week, we're very happy with the result, definitely. I don't think there's anyone that backed us to go down to San Diego. That's a team that's been together for a while.
Except me.
thanks a lot. I think it was good because of the whole dynamic of New York. The guys not staying all together, our training facilities, you've been here now, it's a little bit rough. We train on an island. After the training sessions, the guys, we don't stay together like most professional teams. So everyone scatter off into the directions where they stay, or have the guys have to go to work or come from work. So we don't have a lot of team bonding time here. And like guys like Ben Foden and some of the props, those guys only got here like literally 2 weeks ago. So we don't really have a preseason with them. And I think this trip helped a lot of it, just to identify some of the personalities in the group, see who's the new leaders, who's the guys with new experience. And overall, I think we had really a nice experience. And I think it can only get better from here on forward. In 2 weeks' time, we go down to NOLA Gold, and then a week after that, we go to Seattle. That's going to be the same situation. It's about a three-hour difference, time difference, from us to Seattle, or where we were this weekend in San Diego. And that makes a big difference with eating, sleeping. And for the guys, it's definitely a bit of a new thing. And then the length of the season is also going to be a major factor, because there's a lot of the American guys, the international guys, is away now for the next 5 weeks. So we lost Dylan Fawcett and John Kirk Quill for the couple of weeks. And then when they come back, but luckily we're not the only team that's losing players. There's a lot of the other teams that also lose players. So that's going to have definitely an effect on the games for the next couple of weeks as well.
You spoke about the training facilities and things being all over the place. Just take us through the structure of the club and who else is part of the coaching team, and then also where you will be playing your matches.
Yeah, so in New York, the space is a massive problem. And so at the moment, we're training on Randall's Island. It's an island, I would say, between Manhattan and Brooklyn at the northern part of New York. It's government-owned land, and there's a pitch that they allocated for us that we can use as training. But it's outside, it's uncovered, and like I said, it's now -7 degrees outside. The wind is there. You've been there. You've seen the facilities. It's probably the most hardest training environment that I've ever experienced in my life. And the other guys that works with me at the moment is Coach Mike Tolkien. He's been with America for a couple of years now. He's been involved with the national team as a defense coach and as head coach in the previous World Cup. So we got a lot of experience, and I'm very grateful for him, because he's used to this environment. He's used to this whole New York setup. And I think if it wasn't for him, I probably would have packed my bags a little while ago. Yeah. Otherwise, the team, like I said, we want to go professional as far as possible, but it's very difficult with the salary cap and all that. There's a lot of restrictions in this league, and especially in New York, it makes it very difficult to go with the salary cap that's on the league to go 100% professional.
And where will you be playing your matches when you eventually play a home game?
Yeah, so they allocated as a baseball field on the end of Coney Island. There's a little baseball field that they found suitable for us, and they will convert that baseball field into a rugby field for us where we will play our games. So, but apparently there's still a bit of work to do. So not physically in Manhattan. It's about an hour and a half, depends where you're coming from, on the edge of Coney Island. Yeah. We will play the games.
I noticed your first home game is only on the 15th of March against Toronto. So obviously it's because of those issues, and possibly also because of the weather, that they want to delay the matches in New York until then.
Yeah, that's definitely the reason why we only play. So I think we have got the first six games as all away games. And that put it again. And then we have this weekend and next weekend off as well because of that reason. Where the other teams is going to have a bit of I think their whole season is... The structure of the season is a little bit better. They don't get their two bye weekends straight after each other. But it's just because of the weather situation at the moment. For us, it's just too cold to go outside. And then the fields, we don't have the fields. And I don't think spectators are going to go and sit outside as well, because we don't have a covered area. So for us, the first six games on the road, that's going to be a tough one for us. It's going to be difficult. Hey, but it's a challenge, and if we can come away, I would say, with 4 to 5 wins on that, after that six, we will take it anytime. But it's a massive challenge for us, and we're looking forward to it.
I noticed that you did say you got two bars, and you play NOLA Gold. Of course, by that time, they would have played three matches, and they scored six tries against the Arrows this weekend, so clearly their attack is extremely impressive. And they would have had three games behind them while you're sitting at home in the cold. So obviously that's a huge advantage for them.
Yeah, no, definitely. And they're going to be a little bit more game fit. They're going to be definitely the team is going to be gelling a little bit more as a unit. I think they will sort out a lot of their little problems like usually you do in the beginning of a season. But again, I think it can be in our advantage as well, because they also lose some players to the national team. And hey, because these guys are not in America used to long seasons, I think the week rest of 2 weeks rest for us can be a bit of a, because the guys is not familiar with professional rugby, and the impact, there was like some really big impacts. So I don't want to hope they get injuries, but we know there's going to be one or two of their players is not going to be back by the time we play them. And then there's always a possibility that they can pick up one or two injuries in this next two games that they're going to play, and that we can use an advantage again against them. So, but definitely that they will be better prepared, better jolt in 3 weeks' time that we play them than they was this weekend. That's a fact. And that's just putting a lot more pressure on us to go down there and put up a proper performance again.
If you had to sum up the style of Rugby United New York, I mean, you've only played one match, but what are you aiming for? What do you want to achieve other than victories? How do you want to play?
Yeah, I think our philosophy is to have a solid set piece. So have a good foundation for the backs to play off. And because I think we got really exciting backline players. And then we like to spread the ball. We want like to get the ball to the edges. So in, I would say in comparison, maybe a little bit like the Cheetahs of before, exciting rugby in the forwards can mix it up if it's necessary. But then we like to get the ball to the wings and to the backline players. We got Luke Hume at fullback, that's very exciting. We got Ben Foden, unbelievably experienced in the backline. And then we got some really exciting wings as well. So. And there's even a couple of guys that didn't make the squad this weekend that's still at home that also can come in and give a lot of experience and excitement for us in the back line. So, the challenge is going to be for us as forwards to lay the foundation and to give those guys the room and the quick and a good ball to play from.
And just take us back to sometime last year when you approached Rugby United New York, considering you were living there. How did that whole thing come about?
Oh, I've got here, I first came to New York in November the year before, I think it was 2017, came to visit my wife, and I got introduced to two guys, Steve Lewis and Matt McCarthy. Matt McCarthy got another show, Rugby Wrap-Up, and actually Matt introduced me to Steve, and Steve is big in American rugby. He's just been awarded this year as the top coach of the year in the USA. And I just was like fishing around a little bit, what's the rugby environment in New York? But because I wasn't sure at that moment, we were supposed to stay in Japan still. But then 6 months later, my whole environment changed and I had to change from Japan, and I followed my wife to New York. And as I got here in the first week, Steve invited me to an Old Blue as one of the big clubs in New York, or probably I think is one of the better clubs in New York, to their year end function, because their season finished end of June, July, their season finished. And there I got introduced to the owner of Rugby, RUNY, we call it now, Rugby United New York. James Kennedy. And then they said to me, but they're busy setting up this American league here and they want to create a team, and they'll get in touch with me. And about a month later, I had an interview with James, and they were happy about what they were seeing. And then I was coaching, I was helping out, because Old Blue was also a little bit short on staff at that stage. And I went and I helped them in the their pre-season there and then in the season. And we had really a good season. We won the championship here in New York, and we played against the Chicago Lions. We won that game, and it was the best. We went unbeaten for seven games, and it was one of the best seasons that Old Blue had for a long time. And I think that helped a little bit to get me into the old Rugby United thing. And yeah, from there on, it was just like hard work and a little bit of frustrations, because like I said, I'm used to a professional environment. And here, there's just a lot of things that still need to happen and need to get into place. Yeah.
You've obviously played and coached all over the world. Where would you put Major League Rugby in the overall level of world rugby?
Oh, it's a difficult one, because you need to compare apples with apples. So, I would say Probably at the moment, we round about a Vodacom level, a Vodacom Cup level, or probably a second division. And if you go to England, the second division teams, I would say it's competitive. It's definitely much better. I think this first round, if you look at the games, if you look at Seattle against Glendale, there was high impact. The guys played high tempo. There was less mistakes. So the quality of the game is definitely going to improve year by year. And it looks like it's going to improve quite quickly because the coaching is good. The guys spend a lot more time now with rugby than before. So I think at the moment it's difficult to really make a comparison because like I said, you need to play against one of those overseas teams to really know. But at the moment, what I think, I would say like a good Vodacom Cup side, a good second division side in England, that's probably the level that we are now at. And maybe I think the top teams can maybe be even a little bit better than that. Yeah, so.
And from a South African point of view, I mean, you do have, I know you've got Alvain van Vieren, the South African, involved in your squad there. There's obviously opportunities for South Africans in the future as the competition grows, because we know teams are being added next year, and the experience that those youngsters and coaches can bring could help the American rugby scene.
Yeah, definitely. The biggest issue at the moment is the visas for the South African players. I know with Alvin and especially, we haven't received this clearance on his visa still. So Alvin, although the season has started, we're waiting now about 3 months or maybe longer for Alvin's visa. So we all, it's just a waiting game. We need to wait until hopefully he get approved soon and then he can come and join us here. We're not the only guy that's waiting for visas. I know a lot of the teams are still waiting. I know the coach, the guy, Seattle's coach visa got declined. And they had appointed another coach. So there's definitely still problems with the visas and guys getting into the country to come and help you. But like you said, there's going to be a lot of opportunities for young guys. What I understand from the American system, they wanted to get guys with high experience. So guys that played at a super rugby level or international level or higher. Unfortunately, those players is not cheap. So, because they can go to Europe and they can go and get good money there. So, to get that quality of player into America is, I think, we're a little bit off still because of the salary cap. And that's the challenge for us at the moment. But that there's going to be, over the next 10 years, creating opportunities, and this market is going to grow definitely. There's definitely going to be opportunities for young, talented kids over here to come here. And I think to improve the game here, because like again, these guys in South Africa, rugby is a lifestyle. We play from as long as you're old enough to hold a ball, you've got a rugby ball in your hands. Over here, there's 100 other sports that they first get introduced to, and then at the end they make a decision to play rugby. So yeah, but there's going to be opportunities in America definitely.
And obviously, you were talking about how important it is to lay the foundation with the forwards. Obviously, that's your responsibility. But just take us through the story of struggling to find a lollipop in America and how I had to help you out with that.
Yeah, so the Americans at the moment, are, as far as I've known, they're not familiar with the lollipop. And I don't know if the people out know, they don't actually know what a lollipop is. But it's just the pole that we like to use for the hookers to throw, to have a couple of extra reps. With their throw-ins. So, and luckily I had someone in South Africa that worked at the engineering company, and I knew that I need to make the lollipop, because the traditional lollipop is just a long pole with a plate at the top that you lift up and the hookers use it as a target throwing. But I knew, because of all the traveling, I can't have a 3 meter long pole taking it on the plane. So I need to make it like detachable. So I've got someone in South Africa that helped me engineer a lollipop for me, and great product. But the issue was to get that lollipop in time from South Africa to America. And then luckily, I put it up on Facebook, and you contacted me, Brendan, and you were so kind enough to put it in your luggage and brought it over for me. And I must say, all the guys are so happy, especially my hookers. They are really happy. And I don't think there's one training session that we haven't used it yet. So hopefully we can get that introduced a little bit more into American rugby. And yeah, there's probably opportunities there. Yeah.
So have you started engineering it yourself somewhere in Brooklyn?
I was looking into it, but at the moment I think my the one that I've got at the moment is a little bit heavy, and I want to make it a little bit more accessible to kids to lower grades. So I need to look at the kind of material that I use at the moment. So I've started with it, but like you said, it's in the season now. We got 110 things to do. So I'm still, it's still an idea, but I need to get it out there, and I need to tweak my design a little bit. So, because I think it's definitely a must if we want to grow the game this side. But I need to tweak my design a little bit and fix it up. So, but it's still in the planning, definitely in the planning.
And lastly, I'm sure you'd know that there were only 10 points between all four matches over this weekend. And yes, every team walked away at least one losing bonus point. That's got to be exciting for Major League Rugby as a whole, that the teams are so closely matched.
Yeah, no, I think it's great for the competition, definitely. And for a little bit scary as well, because we know for a fact there's not one week that's going to be this weekend is an easy game. It's going to be a battle. Every week is going to be a battle. And that's what you want to see. And I think that's what the spectators want to see. And that's going to make the season so much interesting. And that's why I'm thinking, know that winning games away from home, that's going to be crucial coming to the end of the season, where the season is going to get long, guys going to pick up injuries. And by the end of the season, all those teams have to travel all the way up to New York. Mm-hmm. And how are they going to adapt to a 5.5 hour flight and come and play in New York? So again, like I think it's amazing for the whole competition that there was such a slow points difference.
Well, for all those rugby fans in America and around the world, if you haven't picked a team yet, Rugby United New York will never turn you away as a fan. You can follow them at Rugby United NY on Twitter and Facebook. Kees, all the best for the season. Please send your wishes to the rest of the guys from South Africa, and thank you very much.
Oh man, Brendan, I really appreciate this, and thanks a lot again for bringing me my lollipop. And again, thank you for the support. We really appreciate it. We really need it. And yeah, good luck in South Africa that side. And I believe me if I say that we miss the weather of South Africa a little bit.
And of course, you can watch my weekly show at Rugby in the Majors on YouTube. So thanks a lot and cheers.
Yeah, thank you, Brendan. Have a nice day.